Welcome to Smart Catalyst, November 30, 2018. So today we are going to see all these prelims article. The first one is ISRO puts Shore Pi into orbit. The second one is RBI moves to ease the liquidity for NBFCs. The third article is every third child is malnourished. It is found by Global Nutrition Report 2018. So the first article is ISRO puts Shore Pi into orbit. So what the news here is, India recently launched a rocket which carries 31 satellites along with the HISIS, which is the hyperspectral imaging satellite, which is a Earth observation satellite, on Thursday. So this rocket is PSLV C-43. It is a four-stage rocket and it weighs about 230 tons. So this actually carries one Earth observation satellite along with 30 satellites of other countries. Okay, like Australia, Canada, Colombia, Finland, and nearly 23 satellites from US. So this HISIS is the 45th flight of PSLV and 13th flight of Core Alone version. And this HISIS is injected into a precise orbit of 636 km, which is the lower Earth orbit. Okay. So lower Earth orbits means generally it is like between 160 to 2000 km. So this satellite was launched into this orbit only, okay, low Earth orbit, and it is launched southwards 27 degree south of equator. Okay, so what is the purpose for this HISIS? In the sense, it is having a lot of applications including agriculture, forestry, soil survey, geology, till pollution detection from industries. So now we are going to see what is this HISIS, which is hyperspectral imaging satellite. It is an Earth observation satellite and it has an optical imaging detector chip, and this is the chip, and it is indigenously developed by Space Application Center of ISRO. Okay, so by means of this we can see 55 spectral or color bands from the lower Earth orbit above the ground. Okay, so by means of observing this much spectral bands, we can easily, precisely and distinctly identify the objects from a very longer distance. So by means of this precise identification of objects, we can easily locate the minerals, terrestrial vegetation, man-made materials. So like all these kind of resources can easily be identified by means of this HISIS. So it is a best ever high resolution Earth imaging satellite. So one thing you have to note here is the US, the China and the EU. So these are the some of the other countries which having these kind of systems as sophisticated as our hyperspectral imaging camera. Okay. So some of the previous attempts of ISRO are like, so this one is hyperspectral imaging satellite, right? Similarly, previously microwave and radar imaging satellite, which are RISAT-1 and RISAT-2, it was also developed by ISRO. So it has the capacity of seeing through the clouds and dark space also, okay? So that much efficient it is, and it was useful for military and security agencies in the past, okay? So these are some of the successful attempts by ISRO. So the second article is RBI moves to ease the liquidity for NBFCs. So what this article talks about is, recently RBI relaxed the rules for NBFCs to sell or to securitize their loan books in a bid to ease the persistent stress in the sector. So in order to tackle the stress in the NBFC sectors, they are now relaxing the NBFC norms. Thereby, they can sell or securitize their loan books. Okay. So now we are going to see what this securitization means. So it is a process where the underlying pool of assets of the NBFCs is packaged and sold as a financial instrument to the investors. So when means, if the NBFC is failed to return the money back to the investors after the maturity period. Okay, so that means you are making the investors more safer by means of this mechanism. So for example, consider if any investor is giving money to the NBFC for a period of 5 years and get the commercial paper back, in this case he has to feel more safe, right? And for that, the NBFC, what it is going to do is, it is going to securitize their loan by means of associating its assert, that is NBFC's asserts with that commercial papers. Okay, so it is like, if in case I fail to return the money, then the assert of the NBFC, you can take that as a guarantee. So this is what the meaning is. So what the recent change by the RBI here means, initially the NBFC has to hold, like for 1 year it has to hold that assert, and then only it has to securitize it with the commercial paper or the investor. But now it is relaxed to 6 months. That means now it can hold only up to 6 months, and then it can easily securitize to the investor. Okay, so the time period with which the NBFC is holding its pool of assets is called this minimum holding period. So by means of relaxing this minimum holding period, it will increase the liquidity in the market, as well as it increase the credibility of the investors. So one more thing you have to note here is RBI also increase the interest subsidy for MSME sectors and only for exporters. Okay, so the interest subsidy is increased from 3% to 5%, okay, in order to increase the exports of the MSME sector. So the last prelims article is, every third child is malnourished, found by Global Nutrition Report 2018. So this Global Nutrition Report 2018 is an independent peer-reviewed report. Okay, so according to this Global Nutrition Report, the current burden of malnutrition of each and every country is unacceptably high. Though it is very high, the countries have never been better equipped to fight the malnutrition. So this is a major concern, right? And also the report states that of 141 countries which are taken into account, nearly 28% of the countries are affected majorly by three forms of malnutrition. One is stunting among the children, and then second one is anemia, and third one is obesity among the women. Okay, so we have to address all these things. And one more thing in that report is, nearly 88% of that 141 countries are suffering from at least two forms of the above mentioned malnutrition. Okay, so if you see in this picture, nearly 22.2% of children globally are affected by stunted growth, and nearly 7.5% of the children are wasted children, that means very lesser weight, and nearly 5.6% of the children are overweight children. So these are all one or other forms of malnutrition, right? So this Global Nutrition Report is majorly taking these 8 parameters into account. One is the adult high blood pressure, second one is adult obesity, adult overweight, anemia. And in terms of childhood, it means childhood stunting, wasting and overweight, and finally salt intake. Okay, so these are the key nutrition indicators, and by means of taking this only, they calculated this kind of results. And the result also point out that in situation of crisis, especially during the conflict among the countries or fragility and violence in any particular area, or the environmental change due to the global warming, these are making the situation even more worse, and we have to take all these things into consideration, and we have to treat and prevent these kind of multiple burdens of malnutrition, while also we have to build parallelly the nutrition resilience to the affected children. So now we are going to see the Indian scenario in terms of malnutrition. So in terms of stunting and in terms of wasting, India only tops the list of countries. So we are bad at this. Nearly 46.6 million children and 25.5 million children are affected by stunting and wasting. And in terms of overweight also, we are one among the more than million overweight children, like China, Indonesia, Egypt, etc. And one more thing from the report here is, in urban areas, there are 7.1% overweight children on average, and in rural areas, 6.2% children are overweight in average. And this kind of overweight is mostly common among the boys than in girls. So these are highlighted by that Global Nutrition Report. So now we are going to see the mains article. The first one is walking the tightrope. The second one is on labor loss due to heat waves. And the third one is pollution by numbers. The fourth article is need for the reforms in education sector. And the fifth article is number theory on lowering the UPA era GDP growth rate. And the last mains article is the case for a progressive international. So now we are going to see the first mains article, which is walking the tightrope. So what the news here is, it is talking about how India has to balance its relationship either in terms of economy or in terms of strategy with both the US as well as Iran. Okay, so this is what this walking the tightrope article means. So now we are going to see that. So the 6-month waiver granted by the US to India as well as to other 7 countries for importing the oil from Iran, it highlights the importance of economic factors in India-US strategic partnership, right? So they are actually giving some kind of waiver to us. So it shows how US is thinking like India is very important to us in terms of both economy as well as in terms of strategic partnership. So now we have seen this waiver, right? So for what this waiver is given, in the sense, it is dealing with CARTSA, right? So CARTSA means Countering America's Adversaries Through Sanctions Act, which actually prohibit any kind of trade relationship with Iran, North Korea and Russia to any other countries. So we have, if any country deal or having trade with these countries, then it is obviously coming under the ambit of CARTSA, and US is going to put sanctions over those countries. So despite of this CARTSA, India is having a lot of defense deals with Russia and oil import from Iran, right? For that only, US is now giving a 6-month breathing space, okay, in order to maintain the US-India relationship. But one more concern over here is China, which is a major threat for both India as well as US, is also getting this grant or 6-month waiver from US. So this is a concern, right? So waiver, this kind of waiver or relaxation by the US is actually showing how US and India will cooperate in terms of India's oil and gas needs. We all knew that nearly 80% of India's oil demand is met only by means of imports, especially imports from Gulf countries like Iran, Saudi Arabia, right? So in order to reduce the dependency from those countries and in order to increase the dependency from US, now actually in US and India has signed a deal called Strategic Energy Partnership in 2018. So under this, a task force or a joint task force is set up between India and US, which is especially dealing with in terms of natural gas, because if you see, US is a major shale gas producing country, okay? So it has more resources of shale gas. So by means of utilizing this, it will try to export more natural gas and crude oil or oil needs, whatever we are requesting, okay? So in order to promote the strategic and economic interest of the two nations also, this task force is appointed. So now we are going to see what this actually, that walking the tightrope means. So it means how India can benefit from both US as well as Iran by means of having a smoother and strategic relationship between these two countries. So the first major thing is the American naval power. It is very superior to any country's naval power. So we have to, that is India has to make use of that opportunity. Thereby, it can preserve its maritime freedom both in Indian Ocean region as well as in the South China Sea region. So we have to make use of that. And so if you see in terms of Iran, India has had a bilateral trade deficit with Iran over many years. That means we are importing lot of oil from Iran. Thereby, we are having lot of bilateral trade deficit with Iran. So in 2017, it is like nearly $8.5 billion. So Iran is the only country which actually accepts the deal, that is the trade, in terms of rupees rather than in terms of dollars, okay? So it gives that much advantage to us, right? So not all other countries are actually accepting these kind of rupees exchange agreement, right? It is only giving that kind of opportunity. So we have to increase the trade with Iran in terms of that. Thereby we can strengthen our rupee also, right? So the second major benefit that we will get from Iran is in terms of the trade route via Iran by means of this international north-south transport corridor. This is what this north-south transport corridor means. So here we are, right? So through Iran, we can easily reach Russia as well as we can easily reach the Europe as well as the Central Asian region. So by means of using Iran as a trade route, we can easily increase our trade relationship with all other countries which is in the northern side. So this is what this north-south transport corridor, okay? So for increasing this also, Iran can be a better option. And last one is India has been developing the Chabahar port in Iran, and it is also a strategically important thing because it again it connects the Central Asia through Iran and Afghanistan. So Afghanistan, in the sense, India as well as all the developed nations usually wants to make Afghanistan a more stable region. That means it should be free from the terrorist activity or free from terrorism, as well as there should be more development in that region. So in order to achieve that, first we have to reach Afghanistan, right? And that is possible only through Iran. So that is should also be explored, okay? So these are how India can benefit from both US and Iran, okay? So the next article is Cool It, which is on the topic of labor laws due to the heat waves. So the performance of any individual depends only on the environment that he or she survives. So if you see, we generally know that the people in the temperate region are little bit more efficient than the people in the tropical region. This is mainly because of the difference in the temperature. Here it is somewhat lesser temperature, here it is more temperature, right? So if temperature is going to increase, it is going to affect the performance of the people as well as individual. So this report is based on that only. If more number of people are exposed to heat waves, then the performance of the entire community or entire country is going to get degraded. So this is about 2018 Lancet countdown on the health and climate change, okay? So as per this report, nearly 153 billion hours of labor are lost due to the increase in temperature, that is this heat waves, okay? It is all around the globe. And this is a data for 2017. So if you see in this picture, the change in the number of people who are getting exposed to heat waves are increasing, right? So it is a major concern because if more people exposed to heat wave, it is the more less efficient it is. And if you see in terms of India, it is also affected by this rising frequency of heat wave, and it nearly loses about 75 billion hours of work. Why this much means? We all knew that our population is very high, so obviously it creates more impact in our country, right? So because more people are getting exposed. So what the country should do now? So we have to reduce the share of coal in the energy mix through the sustained support for renewable energy. That means we have to shift from the coal or fossil fuels to the renewable energy. Thereby we can reduce the emissions or pollutions. Thereby we can reduce the heat waves. And the second one is introduction of more electrical vehicles rather than the fossil fuel based vehicles. So one more fact you have to note down here is the UNFCCC's COP24, which is Conference of Parties 24th meeting, is going to take place in Katowice, which is in Poland, okay? So in this, they are going to make use of this Lancet report. That means they are going to discuss about this report, and then they are going to derive at some policies. Thereby, they can reduce the climate change. So the next article is pollution by the numbers. So this article talks about whatever the index that is calculated by any country. So in terms of HDI or Human Development Index or Multidimensional Poverty Index or any index, it is taking only the social and the economic factors into account. And these kind of index never take the environmental factors into account, right? So what we are going to lose because of this not including the environmental factors into account in the sense, the environment is degrading, especially because of the pollution. So the pollution is the major environmental risk to the health. It kills more people. For every year, nearly 7 million people are dying due to these kind of pollution. But if we are not including these factors into the index, then what is the use of those index? So we should have some kind of index which include these kind of environmental degradation also into account, right? So for that only, the Asian Development Bank created one index which is Inclusive Green Growth Index, which is IGGI, which will help to close the gap of non-availability of data in terms of environmental factors. Okay, what the news here is, there is no enough attention for the data collection and analysis with respect to the air quality, especially in India and China, like these kind of emerging economy. There is no data for the air quality indicators, so we are missing something here, right? So even though these countries are trying to collect the data in terms of air quality, there is not enough ground level data to provide a clear picture for the specific factors which is affecting these kind of air quality. So now this IGGI is believed to close this gap. Okay, so now we are going to see what is this. So this IGGI is aims to assess the country's performance not only based on economic and social parameters but also on environmental factors. So environmental status of Asia, if you see, then the ADB's IGGI data shows that in terms of Asia, the highest performer of environmental sustainability, that is the good performer, is Singapore, followed by Bhutan, and then Sri Lanka and Laos. But in terms of national level or global level, China has been doing better and impressive work in order to improve its pollution data. That is, more data is now getting included, that is more environmental data, in order to guide its environmental strategy. So now we are going to see what China is doing in order to reduce its carbon emission as well as greenhouse gas emissions. So China is following a method which is called carbon pricing system. So by means of this carbon pricing system, they are fixing some kind of threshold or limitation for the emission of the carbon dioxide. Okay, so if you are crossing the threshold or if you are emitting more than the limit, then you are coming under the ambit of this carbon pricing system and you have to pay a certain amount for the amount of carbon dioxide that you are released above this mentioned level. Okay, so how this carbon pricing system works means high frequency data which is collected through continuous emission monitoring system, and this data provide crucial information regarding the sources of the air pollutants, whoever releasing the pollution. So that is, they can be easily obtained by means of this data, and this enables the government to create an effective incentives for those firms to curb the emissions. So this kind of China's newer policy is actually contributed to nearly 13.9% reduction in sulfur dioxide emission, especially from coal-fired power plants. So this is a good move, right? So this is a clear lesson for India. So we have to learn from, or we have to inspire from China, and we have to also adopt the same kind of carbon reduction or greenhouse gas emission reduction policies. So the only way we can hope to overcome these kind of environmental challenge is we have to make use of every tool which is available. Thereby we can increase the efficiency. So we should not focus only on the social and economical factors. We should include more and more indicators as possible. Thereby we can reduce or we can make less and less pollution and emission. So more emphasis should also be given on the IPCC's latest report, which clearly indicates the importance of making the climate change stable, as well as we have to reduce it by 1.5 degree Celsius than the pre-industrial levels, right? So we have to give more stress to that also. So the major thing we have to do is we have to first collect the data and use it properly. Thereby we can make right rules for the policies, as well as we can incentivize both the individuals as well as the firms in order to tackle this climate change. So the next article is the need for the reforms in the education sector. So this article talks about how the technology is evolving and how it is going to occupy the place of the human in terms of industries, in terms of science and tech, or in terms of research, etc. So you can clearly see the visible transformation in the society, both in terms of developed as well as in the developing countries, because of the result of the technological process. So the technology is progressing at a very faster rate, and they are enabling each and every firms of the countries to automate, and thereby it will reduce the employment in some old and typically low and medium skill sectors, right? That means automation is increasing because of the technology. So the people are losing the job because machines are occupying their place now. So it is a major concern and we have to address that. So how we can address this means by means of skilling the people. So you have to impart the right skill into the people at the ready. Thereby we can meet these kind of technological challenges. So if you see in terms of India, like emerging markets like India, we are the forerunner of IT sectors, right? So we are at a gaining position. So we have to make use of this opportunity, and you have to, that means India has to give more priority to the skilling of the youths at the ready. Thereby we can leverage these kind of technological changes. So we have seen in the previous slide that we have to skill up our youths, right? So what kind of skills means? Majorly complex problem solving and analysis and social skills, reasoning and self-efficacy, as well as social behavioral changes. These all kind of skills need to be imparted into our people. So this only increases the employable opportunities as well as adaptability of the citizens of any country. So building these kind of skills to the people requires stronger human capital foundation, and it can only be established through effective early childhood development program and basic education. So if you give proper opportunities as well as skills at the early stage, then only it will be a better base for their future progress, right? And not only in terms of skilling at the early stage, but also in terms of investment in nutrition and health, as well as stimulation in the first 1,000 days of life of small child, right? So it also helps to build stronger brains, thereby increase their capacity. So we have to take this also in, it is very crucial point. And the World Development Report 2019, it indicates that India needs to focus even more strongly on the quality of education it offers to its citizen. So we have to focus more on this. This is what the World Development Report stated. So what kind of efforts has been taken by India in the recent days? In the sense, the first one is a lot of investment in human capital have already been begun in India. So for example, Inspire program, Skill India, Startup India, Stand-up India. So we are having a lot of initiatives by the government, right? So it all aims to increase the human capital. And also, there is a shift in the education sector toward more competitive federalism and results-based financing. Thereby, we can improve the accountability and learning outcome. Okay, so this is also a major move which is by Indian government. So the third major government's move is agreeing to participate in PISA, which is Program for International Student Assessment. Okay, so India was actually hesitant to participate in this assessment before because of the lagging performance of our students in the year 2009, but now it again agreeing to participate in this by means of proper training to the students and all. So it shows our positive move towards the education system itself, right? And the last major move by the India is in terms of tertiary education system or higher education system, because India is the second largest education system in terms of higher education in the world after China. So these are all the India's effort in terms of investing more in human capital. As we have seen before, the most prestigious institutions are also helping India to become a world leader in the high technological sector. And also we have seen like the Startup India, the Stand-up India, these kind of initiatives are also by the government in order to increase the research opportunities as well as to promote the innovation through incubation for the people, right? Especially for the students of higher education, right? So these are all the steps by the government. So what kind of reforms now need to be done? In the sense, whatever the steps we are having, we need more kind of flexibility between the general and the technical tracks. So thereby we can easily switch over between these two things. And we have to more focus on building the skills for the people or the citizens. So we have to make the top performing universities as innovation clusters. And we have to encourage the adult learning and flexible delivery models that fit within the adult lifestyles. As well as we have to fix in short-term skilling programs also, thereby they can easily getting skilled. So the next article is number theory on lowering of the then government's GDP growth rate. So what the news here is, the back series GDP data was released on Wednesday by Niti Aayog. So what is the use of these back series GDP data and what is the tussle which is going on in our country? So everything now we are going to see. So reworking the past national account statistics based on the latest base year, which is 2011 and 12. So previously it was like 2004 to 5, right? So this was the base year before, but now it is changed to 2011-12. And you have to rework all the past statistics, which is in accordance to this newer base year, right? So this is an exercise which is done by the government every year. And why they are doing this means to enable precise comparison and analysis of the actual growth rate of any economy, or especially here our economy. But what is the issue here is there is a debate that is going on over the economic growth in the past years, especially under the previous government as well as the now government. Okay. So always there are peaks and dips in the growth of the economy. And the political environment which was prevailing in before scenario is entirely different from now scenario, because it is now deeply polarized and there is a huge difference between the then government as well as the present government. So you have to understand some background here, that is the previous government actually agreed as its biggest achievement of taking India on the highest GDP growth rate, that is especially during the 2010-11. So in that year, what happened means the GDP growth is nearly like 10.3%. It is what they actually estimated. But after revising this data now, they concluded or they found a new trend where the growth rate is not actually 10.3, but it is actually only 8.5% as per the new series. Okay. And not only this 2010-11, but also in year 2005, 6, 7 and all, whatever they are estimating like 9.3 or 9.8 percentage, they are not that much, but it is nearly like 7.9, 7.7 and 8.1 percentage only. So these are all now revised by the present government. And they are stating like the way of calculating the GDP by means of older series is wrong. That is why they are showcasing this much amount of GDP growth, but it is not true. And one more thing they are stressing here is the old series and its calculation is actually underestimating the impact of the global financial crisis of 2008 on Indian economy. That means we actually thought like during the financial crisis, every other countries are facing downward growth, but India is alone going in an upward trend because of its economic stability as well as the RBI reserves and all. So that means India is decoupling from all other countries during that financial crisis, right? But that is not true. And they're actually underestimating the impact of the global financial crisis on Indian economy. So this is also stressed by the present government by means of revising this official back data for GDP. So now we are going to see what are the highlights of those back data revision of GDP means. The data computed by the CSO and it is released by the Niti Aayog shows that India have never seen really a growth in terms of double digit during the 2010-11 because it was projected like 10.3% by the previous government, right? But it is not like the double digit and all, it is only 8.5. That is what they mentioning here. And nor it was a high growth economy. We are also in the same path as other countries and we are also financially weak only during that point. That is what they are mentioning here. So these kind of recalibration of data is necessary, but as the political environment in our country are deeply polarized, it is actually many of the valuable insights which we actually got from these kind of data are lost. So this is what the author is raising a concern. And one more thing is the data generated is by a thoroughly professional organization, which is the CSO, which is a credible organization. So by means of blaming the data calculation by CSO, actually denting the manner of release by this organization, and in terms it is reduced the credibility of the institution as a whole, right? So this is also a major concern which is put forward by the author. So one thing you have to note here is this GDP back series is issued by a committee of National Statistics Commission. Okay. So this National Statistical Commission was established in the year 2005 after the recommendation of Suresh Tendulkar Economic Advisory Council. Okay. So after their recommendation, it was established and it is an autonomous body under MOSP, okay? Ministry of Statistical and Program Implementation. So what is the main or prime purpose of this NSC, which is the National Statistical Commission, means to ensure the collection of data in a fairer way and in a reliable way. So it is mainly deals with the data and its collection, okay? So what is the way forward here means? So in order to tackle these kind of data manipulation or data miscalculation, what India needs to do or what is the need of the hour is we have to invest more in data collection and integration of those data, and we have to also do informal sector surveys more frequently. Thereby we can get the more reliable data, thereby we can reduce the data miscalculation, and robust and updated data should also be there, which should be there, thereby it acts as an security against these politicians' influence over the economic exercise. So the next article is the case for a progressive international. So what this article talks about is, in this hyper-globalized environment, no country can have the power or can have the sovereignty over the cases that it is dealing, and each and every case of each and every country is now becoming a transnational nature. So the cases are now becoming transnational nature, thereby it is directly coming under the ambit of international forums as well as international dispute resolution mechanisms and all, okay? So this is what this article talks about. So India is not an exception to this scenario, and we are also facing these kind of legal claims from international investors in nearly 23 arbitration cases before various tribunals, and India is at a debt or liability of billions of dollars to these international investor or arbitration cases, which especially arises due to the bilateral investment treaties between India and other states. That means, so for example, consider India and Japan or India and China or US or any country which is having bilateral investment treaty, and as per the treaty, what is the provision is, if in case there is any mismatch or any mislead from this agreement, that is, if any country is not obeying or complying with this agreement, then they can directly go to the international arbitration without even resorting to the country's local constitutional mechanisms or institutions. That is, instead of going to Supreme Court or High Court, these countries' firms are directly going to the international firms. Okay, so this is a major disadvantage, right? First you have to explore the local options, then only you have to go to the international level options. So because of this alone, now we are at a liability of billions of dollars to the international investors in arbitration cases. So that is what this mentioning. Okay, so what are the disadvantage of this kind of bilateral treaty means? As we saw before, it is directly allow the international investor to go to the international tribunal. MNCs are now directly going to the tribunal, and it bypasses the state's own constitutional system and the courts like the Supreme Court or the High Court. So it is a major disadvantage, and it is giving a lot of stress and burden to our country, right? And if you see here, these kind of cases which are going to the international tribunal, they are mainly dealing with the public health emergencies, economic crisis, or other matters which are involving public welfare. So this is what the major thing. If it is anything wrong happen in terms of public welfare sectors, then it is going to the international tribunal more frequently. So what means, we are going to see it in the next slide. So if you see here, the essential medicines, India is a welfare country, right? So we always give priority to the welfare. So we want to provide cheap and genuine as well as quality products to the people. So for that, whatever the patented medicine which are very costly, we are bringing under the ambit of essential medicines. Thereby we can reduce the price and we provide it to the citizens. So this is what India does usually. But it is now coming under the ambit of international tribunal by means of US and EU pressure, where they are stating like India is providing cheaper medicine which is affecting our trade with Indian country because it is our patented products and they are selling it in a very lower price. So please take necessary steps for that. So they are telling like that. Okay, but if you see, countries like South Africa and Thailand are supporting for these kind of things. You can clearly understand from here, instead of dealing health of our citizens locally, it is our local issue, right? But now it is becoming a global issue. It is opposed by someone and it is supported by someone, and now it is becoming a global issue. So it clearly shows the role of the globalization, right? So it clearly shows that the global problems cannot be solved without the involvement of other countries, right? That is acceptable. But the local problems are now also becoming that kind. That means it is also now inviting all other countries into its ambit. So that is what the major issue here, right? So it should be curtailed. That is what they are stating. This investor state dispute settlement by the international tribunal, their scope should be curtailed. Thereby we can achieve our goal of providing the welfare to the people and all. Okay, so these are some of the courts of international level courts of arbitration for the MNCs between the countries, or for any kind of individuals or institution between the countries. Arbitration court, ICC, ICJ, etc. And it is these kind of clashes are not only happening between two countries, it is also happening between national regulatory authority as well as the corporation within the country. Because the clash between new gig economy such as Uber and Ola, so these employees are recently called for indefinite strike for their low wages. It is not only happening in India, but it is also happening all over the world. So the presence of these kind of companies, so the global presence of these companies are also showing that these kind of conflict may take different form in different countries, but there are always certain kind of similarities between the conflicts which is taken place. So the conflict is actually transnational in character. So this is also indicating the globalization and its impact. So the third one is the investment treaties. So this also indicating like it is difficult for one country to tackle the problem alone, especially when the corporation is global in character. So if it is an MNC, it has its global presence. So you cannot handle the problem in local level. You have to handle it in an international level, right? For example, DiEM 25, which is Democracy for European Movement 25 issue. So what this issue means? So this DiEM 25 issue is, it is a pan-European political movement, okay? Which is launched in the year 2015 by former Greek finance minister. Why? Because it actually arose only after the debt crisis in Greece. We all knew that the debt crisis in Greece, right? So after the debt crisis, there was an imposition of wide ranging of structural adjustment program of the Greek, which is imposed by European Commission, European Central Bank, as well as IMF. So these are all forcing the Greek to have some kind of structural changes, like reduce the public funding. Thereby, we can improve the health of the Greek. Okay, so this is what they're actually aiming at. But what its latent impact are, it actually causes a huge unemployment problem in Greece. Okay, and also there is a widespread privatization which is prevailing, which is also hindering the opportunity for the public sectors to thrive. So these are all actually instigate the Greek people to come into this kind of pan-Indian political movement, which is DiEM 25. So movement like these sprung up in various parts of the world actually serves as a potential blueprint as well as a model of how the progressive international may look like. So India must also take heed of it, and we should learn from all these things, right? So this is what the author stated in this article.